Okay. We appear to have drifted apart. I don't know one person in comedy that I used to hang out with, and that used to be my entire world. I lived upstate with David Cross. We bought some land together. The Samantha Bee and Jason Jones lived nearby. We'd always come over and have barbecues. Things would get a little political, and it would get uncomfortable, but we just sort of avoid it. Like if I was a Scientologist or something, and that people didn't want to get into being totally clear.
Right.
But obviously with Trump, everyone is just sort of ka-chunk.
Yeah, now you just journey separate ways on the way home every day.
Yeah, that's exactly what it is. Was David Cross always into underage girls? Was that always his thing?
I think everyone's into pretty girls. And when you're ugly and bald and a pretty girl likes you, you can adapt.
What's the barrier of age at that point?
I used to feel like that was the case with when you watched To Catch a Predator. It started, and you would see these guys. When the show started, you'd have these, 50-year-old men, and they'd be talking with them as on chat boards as 12-year-old boys. Like, that's really sick and perverted. But then they would have, like, a 22-year-old woman posing as a 17-year-old. And I was like, these are just computer tech guys who will take anything they can get. Not justifying it.
It becomes entrapment. It's not like they're taking pedophiles off the street. They're taking very low IQ, desperate people off the street who, by the way, we're talking to a 40-year-old man writing as a little girl saying, like, I love sex and I love doing it with lots of guys, that which 13-year-old girls don't say.
Well, they would have like 21-year-old women sending pictures just dressed a little bit younger saying they were seven. And then when I watched, that's when I got over the Chris Hansen. I was like, okay, this is entrapment at this point. Okay, yeah, speaking of low IQ, so Samantha Bee, this happened today. What's your take on this? The last thing you ever want to be is a part of the pitchfork mob. But like we just talked about this earlier, the difference between Samantha Bee and Roseanne is not just the severity of it. It's not just the double standard from the left. You don't want to do the yeah, but the difference is not the double. The difference is she gets an award for this as opposed to fired. It's not just accepted. It is lauded. What do we do with that?
Can you even perceive? Go drop acid and be... Go drop acid alone in a forest in a bathtub with perfect silence and try to imagine someone saying anything remotely like that about Obama's kids. It's unfathomable.
Yeah.
Now, my deal with my enemies is I listed them all on my show today, and it's like the globalists and the media and academics and Antifa and these corrupt lawyers. I don't include comedians in my enemies list because I think art is off the books.
Right.
So you can hold Trump's head with blood coming out of it. You're not my enemy. You're just bad at art and it's derivative and boring.
Right.
But I think that no one can deny that there's a double standard here. And they were just waiting to pounce
No one is
waiting to pounce on Samantha Bee.
No, exactly. And she got an award for this. That's the thing that I find so important. And one thing also, Vice, obviously, Vice, which tends to be really far left now, they held the feet to the fire. We just talked about it, the liberal arts colleges and these gatekeepers were like, well, if you're going to come to our school, you represent our point of view and our brand. So you have to tell these jokes. And I was going, well, hold on a second. As a comedian, and you know this, and I think you'll be doing some shows possibly with Owen Benjamin, Nick DiPaolo. I might join in on a couple here later in the year. You know that you've never, as a comedian, seen yourself as an extension of the brand of the club or of the venue. You speak for yourself. That's what comedy has always been. Samantha Bee, on the other hand, doesn't do that anymore. She really does have to do the bidding of TBS, Viacom, Time Warner. If you look at the money trail, you look at all the writers, she cannot just say, I speak exclusively for myself. And that's where I think it leaves the reservation of comedy a little bit, and you become an active politicizationist.
Comedy is so hard that if you can think of a funny nugget, a funny concept, you better run with that, no matter how partisan it is or what side it's on. It's like finding a needle in a haystack. It's like being a great artist. If you were really good at drawing horses, but you're not supposed to do that and you should draw cartoons, you're going to be a crap artist. You kind of have to sort of go with the serenity of the guy up above. And if he hands you a joke, you have to run with it. So in a way, Samantha Bee's job is harder, because she has to ignore all funny jokes that might lampoon liberals, which she used to do, remember? I remember her making fun of anti-vaccine people over at The Daily Show.
Yeah.
But now it's you're a talking point memo for the DNC, and you have to call Ivanka Trump a C-word because she hugged her child.
Right. Well, you know what else? Well, something else that's two things. I was trying to think of if anyone had ever said anything like this about the Obama children. The closest was, remember David Letterman made the joke about A-Rod with Bristol Palin, about how A-Rod, something like she was sat near the dugout, she got pregnant, A-Rod impregnated her, but it turned out it wasn't Bristol, it was the younger sister. And so the right got really mad and David Letterman apologized. Now that was an actual goof. But even then, I remember seeing that and like, okay, that was a different time compared to now where you're just calling the daughter a C-word of a sitting president. And the fact that she's going, your dad will listen to you, talk to your daddy. I'm like, what happened to being a strong woman? You're just asking her to go sit on dad's lap and tell him to make policy.
No, it was worse than that. She was saying, wear a low-cut dress. She was implying that Donald Trump is easily seduced sexually by the daughter, which is actually worse than the feckless C-word. She doubled down. It was one of the most offensive. It's basically Gigi Allen. The left has become so desperate with Trump derangement syndrome, they sound like a disgusting punk band.
Yeah, well, pretty much. I'm going to pretend like I get that reference, but now it's coming back to me. I know that you lived a life that was seedy and disgusting, waking up in a puddle of your own filth, so I assume the band made you feel comfortable. What would you like to see happen with Samantha Bee? Here's the thing. Here's the thing at my point. Her show shouldn't exist because the ratings are terrible, and she takes more vacation time than anyone I've ever seen in my life. You actually go to the Samantha Bee YouTube channel or TBS, you're like, hold on, she did 6 episodes, she's gone for 12 weeks, and she comes back and does 4? I've never seen anyone work less.
Spoiler, she was paid for all of those.
Yeah, spoiler, she was paid for all of those. She was paid for 77 days she didn't work on the year. And so I don't want to see her fired because she made a comment. I think her show should have been long gone a long while ago. What would you like to see happen with this? She apologized. There you go.
I would like to see her fired and never work again.
Really?
Anyone who criticizes anything on the right should be fired. Anyone who criticizes anything on the left should win an award. Similarly, I don't care what celebrities think unless they like Trump, at which point I want everyone to know about it and we should put them on a pedestal. I am a hypocrite.
And I guess Kanye will be joining you for Thanksgiving.
Kanye, I don't care what any celebrities think except Kanye. Yeah. Him I care about. I don't want Roseanne fired. I want Samantha Bee fired. I want prejudice, bias, and hypocrisy starting today.
Because the guy at the green screen motorcycle has some good ideas.
Yes. What? What?
The green screen motorcycle, him and Kim. Remember that? That
was like, oh, that's right. I forgot about that.
Yeah, you blinked that out.
Was it the
people used to think of the other tape?
Uh-huh, honey. That one.
Yeah, yeah.
Gosh, that was awful. Oh, what a way to put a damper on an interview with a fine man. And when we go, we have to.
Yeah, what a weird reference there, colonless.
No. No, I it's
at least you're not an asshole. I can say that much.
Well, there you go. He was the host of Get Off My Lawn at CRTV, and now Gavin will be panhandling in the streets of New York. So you say you're not friends with anyone in comedy, but you're still friends with, I know, Kumia. I think like guys like Nick DiPaolo, some people who are more right leaning. But I guess
I didn't know those guys back in the old days. Remember,
that's true.
I just saw Tucker last night. Alan Dershowitz doesn't have any friends. His family has ostracized him, so they've gone full Salem witch trials. I would be stunned if any pro-Trump people still know, say, Patton Oswalt or any of those, you know, John Benjamin dudes, Todd Barry. No way.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. And I do think there's more of a divide. I was just talking with some older conservatives on my wife's side of the family where either you just watch CNN and everything not named Fox News, or you watch only Fox News. But the median viewership there is well over 70, whereas at least with young people, and I know that's why you have a split audience. We have an audience where we still have a lot of liberals who come in. They're able to at least curate their own content. Sure, there are algorithms, but they can just as quickly go to Lotta with Crowder or Gavin Show as they can then go to the Young Turks. So I do hope that that's shining a light on this where people can go, hold on a second. Roseanne was yesterday. Today, Samantha's Bee is trending. All I need to do is look at my Twitter trending list, let alone bookmark some pages, and see the discrepancy there. Gavin, what about, we're going to have Kellen Robertson on here after this. Tommy Robinson, you worked with him at The Rebel. What are your feelings on this?
I just went to his house. I was just with him. We were getting hammered and going to Luton's last match of the season. I was with soccer hooligans for 3 days. It was right out of Among the Thugs. One of the funnest 3 days of my life, by the way.
I can imagine.
Here's the deal, very simply, with what's going on with Tommy. Britain has had a successful immigration experiment since the 60s and 70s. They brought on the Jamaicans, a little rough for a while, National Front and all that, but it worked out great. Mm-hmm. They brought on the Indians, a little rough for a while, a little bit of bad wording, rude people. Then it worked out great.
they're still rude, to be fair. Yeah.
What?
They're still rude, to be fair, but I understand your point. Yes.
Okay. They all go to football matches. The Indians and the Jamaicans are at the Luton match that I was at with Tommy.
Right.
Screaming, hey, Tommy Robinson. However, this Muslim experiment isn't from a British Commonwealth. They don't share British ideals, and it is a complete catastrophe. So the state, instead of admitting this and trying to reverse it, they just want to silence anyone who notices this. And Tommy won't shut up about it.
Yeah.
So they throw him in jail without a trial. They try to hide that he's in jail even, and hoping it'll go away. But they just suffer this Streisand effect. There's demonstrations in Tel Aviv, in Melbourne. We're having one in D.C. this Sunday. We're having one in New York.
Yep.
They're going to keep going and keep going.
Yeah, we're gonna probably create actually an ad campaign here on the show in our commercial breaks to show people that we believe in Tommy. And TommyRobinson.online, we'll talk about that more afterward. One thing, final note, to tie this all together, isn't it crazy, Gavin? You talk about, obviously, you were friends with David Cross and Samantha Bee. I don't want to get you in trouble with any of the cool kids club, Gavin. I know how hip you are. See, you and your tattoos you got with your old sailor buddies. But here's the deal. They are throwing their lot in. People like Samantha Bee, who threw her lot in with Snyderman, and then Snyderman was like, thanks, Samantha, but it was 1 week after the sexual harassment scandal. Do you remember that? She's like, you take this off your Twitter. It's like, you literally had a cartoon saying he was Superman, Snyderman. So
yes.
They have tossed their lot in with politicians here who, if they had their way, would have exactly the kind of speech laws that you see in the UK. You see all of these leftist comedians from Canada, where I was raised, almost every comedian I know from Montreal, aside from Mike Ward, they support Trudeau, who supports these draconian speech laws. Why do you think? And do you hope, do you see a silver lining that it's going to turn around? Why are the free speech, the biggest practitioners should be of free speech, comedians, throwing their lot in with people who want to silence them legislatively? I can't get my head around it.
Because they were bullied in high school. This is revenge of the wedgies. And they hate Trump because he's a blonde, white male alpha, and he personifies everyone who's ever been mean to them. Comedians, stand-up comedians, they chose that job because they don't have a family and they don't have enough love. So they stand up on stage and go, love me, I'm a loser. And Trump goes, no, I'm not going to love you. And then they go, get rid of him. They are dogmatic, nerdy fascists.
And that's why you joined the stand-up. Well, something illuminating every single time we come on the show. There's a little bit of truth to that, I'm sure. I mean, listen, you know, he's got the mustache, and he's always looking for a little attention. Put it this way, Gavin McInnes is not walking down the street saying, what are you looking at? You know exactly. All right, it's Gavin _ McInnes. Get off my lawn at CRTV. Thank you very much, Gavin. Love you more than a friend. See, I said it before you.
We will make America great again.